Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome this morning to Emmanuel Church. And to those of you who are on our live stream this morning, we welcome you as well. It's great to have you together here to worship the Lord Jesus with us together. And he's the reason why we're here, right? We're here for him. And you might notice that up toward the front here, our student section is missing. We have 29 between students and adult leaders, 29 people away at a youth retreat this weekend. They'll be getting back actually right toward the end of our church service today. And so I'm going to have four grumpy teenagers this afternoon when they come home. But we are trusting that they're meeting Jesus this weekend, worshiping the Lord together. And so we're going to actually be praying for them here in just a few moments as they're at their retreat. Also, today is the day that our Operation Christmas Child boxes are due back, where we have basic supplies that are being given to children around the world in a way to be able to spread the gospel to them. So they're due back by today. Hopefully, if you picked up these boxes, you remember to bring them in. We have around 100, at least that I know of so far, that were taken and are brought back. So we celebrate that as a church. Thank you for doing that, and we'll pray again also for that this morning, that God will make an impact, gospel impact, through these boxes that were given. Now, there's a couple of things we want you to know about going on in the life of the church. Tonight, there is actually a women's event in our fellowship hall right across the way. It is a night of missions and learning about what's going on around the world, especially through Stephanie Beers, who serves in Uruguay, and she will be with us tonight. So ladies, we want to encourage you to come to the church tonight. It's also during the time of our evening service, and so it'll be mostly men then, I guess, in the evening service, and the women will be there in the fellowship hall. So just take note of that. We invite you out for that tonight. Also, there's not a slide for this, but this coming Saturday in the morning, we'll get you the exact details about this, but we're going to do a parsonage work day. The parsonage, the house here right on the parking lot that Pastor Kyle and Brittany used to live in, we want to do a cleaning day and patching and painting walls where there were things hung and some basic repairs and things. So we invite you to come out this coming Saturday to help with that. We'll send an email out this week with some of the details. We just got that on the calendar in the last day or two. So another thing is that next Sunday, it's really important for you to know that we have our annual meeting. We do a part one in November and a part two in February. At this one, what we're going to be doing is looking at our proposed budget and the list of nominations that we've put forward for electing people to serve in certain positions in the church. And the paperwork for those are out on a table in the foyer. Make sure you pick up a proposed budget and the nomination sheet there. And we would like for all of you to come, even if you're not a member, we'd like you to come to the evening gathering that night for the meeting at 7 o'clock here in this room. And only the members can officially vote, but we want everyone to be there because we want you to see what's happening in the life of our church. And also, after we get through that business portion of things, we're going to be having a time for all of our staff to be able to share some items of vision. What has God done over this last year? Obviously, it's been an interesting year, so we'll hear some highlights and recaps of that. But also, what's God calling us to in the year to come? So if you want to stay plugged into that and hearing what's going on in the life of our church, we invite you to come next Sunday night at 7 p.m. All right, so without further ado, I would like to have a special person come join us up here today. Randy Corbin, Reverend Randy Corbin, is now Pastor Randy Corbin as of today here with us. Woo-hoo! Welcome, Randy and Linda, to our staff here at our church. Pastor Randy's going to be doing a part-time interim role since Pastor Kyle had departed 2 weeks ago. He's going to be filling in the meantime here with us to help oversee the discipleship ministries of the church. Not all of them, because he can't do the work of a full-time guy as a part-time guy. We're not expecting him to do that. I'll just look at you guys and reassure you. So some of the other responsibilities are given to other people. But I also want to just make a note for us as a congregation that a pastoral staff is not to do all the ministry of the church. So even as we're bringing Pastor Randy on, it's not so that he can come and do all the discipleship ministries of the church. Praise the Lord, right? We are told in Ephesians chapter 4 that our job as shepherds is to equip the people of the church to do the work of ministry. So we're equippers and developers, and the body as a whole does the works of ministry of the church. And so we want to just make that distinction, and I want you to know that, so that when Pastor Randy comes to you or is leading in some way, we want you to know that you belong as part of this body and that you have a role here to play. Your spiritual giftings need to be at work together and helping in the discipleship of our church, helping in building the fellowship and outreach of our church. And so he's going to be doing that with us as he comes on to our staff. So so Randy, we're glad you're here. Will you lead us into worship and into the Lord's presence this morning? And again, we're so glad that you have agreed to serve with us at Emmanuel Church.
Thank you so much. In honor of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, would you please stand with me for our time of prayer? Let's pray. O Creator God, come. O Redeemer Son, come. O life-giving, energizing Holy Spirit, come. With the psalmist and with the prophets, we pray, rend the heavens and come down, for we are hungry and thirsty for you. We are weary in our doing and in our thinking. For all week long, we have heard the opinions of the political world, the opinions of blogs of various kinds, of friends, colleagues, teachers, even our own thinking, and we recognize we need a word from heaven. So, Lord, as we move through this service today, come, move upon us through these pews, up and down the aisles, that we will have a tangible sense of your presence, because we desire to leave this place full of your might and power. Some of us are dealing with decisions and we need your direction. Some of us are discouraged and we need divine encouragement. Some of us are confused and we need divine clarity. So God, our eyes are upon you. As we move through this service, we are going to be looking for you. Looking for you as we sing these worship songs. Looking for you as we look into the scripture. Listening for you as the message is declared in the power of the Spirit. And bowing before you, ready to move at your direction. Give us more than reformation, O Lord. Give us divine transformation. We ask for a work of the Spirit. And we pray it not only as we gather here in this place, but we pray it for our youth, Lord. Thank you for them. We love them. And we ask, Lord, that your Spirit would rest heavily upon them and minister to them in ways in which they will move forward in dedication and surrender to you. Lord, we know this ministry, our ministry is not just about us, but it is about the gospel declared. And we thank you for the opportunity that we have to declare the gospel. And we just dedicate right now these Operation Christmas Child boxes that will be going out around the world. We pray that they will carry the truth, the liberating truth of Jesus in the lives of these children and young people that will receive them. We want your name to be praised. So, Lord, summing up all of that we want today, it's simply this. We want Jesus. Jesus in our heart and life. Show yourself, O God, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights above.
Praise him, all you angels. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars.
Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the skies.
Let them praise the name of the Lord. Exalted. To save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was with the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God.
Washed by his blood, come and rejoice in his great love.
Freedom I
right where you are. Just want to invite you into a spirit of praise. Praise Him for who He is. Thank Him for what He's done. Lord, we worship You. We thank You for what You did for us on the cross. Lord, forgive us for the times that we have taken You for granted, where we have lost sight of You, Lord. We worship You this morning. Praise You, Jesus, for who You are. We've sung about Your creation. All the things in this earth have praised Your name, Lord. We come before You as a congregation. We worship You, Jesus. We love You, Jesus. Holy Spirit, we pray that You would come and take this place, Lord. Forgive us for the times that we have not praised You for who You are, who we have forgotten who You are, Lord. Jesus, sweep through this place.
Victorious.
which rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken, we trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust in the name of Jesus.
Father, you are the only King and the only King forever. You are above all things. You're above all nations, above all peoples, above all politics, above all molecules. Everything in this world bows underneath the weight of your glory. And so also do we this morning. And yet we admit that we have not been the kind of citizens that are worthy of your kingdom, Father, because we've strayed far from you. We have minds that are divided and distracted. And so what we need this morning is that loving grace of the Savior, your emissary who comes on rescue mission to bring us back into the fold again. And we rejoice, Father, that there is nothing, there is no one that is outside of your reach. Because the scripture tells us that when we were weak, while we were yet your enemies, you sent your only Son to come and rescue us. And so, Lord, shower us this morning with the realization that the love that brought Jesus into humanity, the love that made him obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross, is available for us this morning. That you would do something in this hour that would draw a line in the sand and propel us into kingdom service. That we would look back on this day and say, Lord, you did something that we cannot even imagine. So, Father, I ask this morning for myself and my brothers and sisters that if Jesus Christ is that blessed fount which gives us life and refreshment and nourishment, that we would not be the kind of people content to look at that fount from afar and admire its beauty, but that we would run recklessly up to the edge of the waters and drink deeply, imbibing the glory and the power that comes through your Son by the power of the Holy Spirit. We are desperate for you, Father. And this world is desperate for lovers of Jesus. And so we ask that you would do that work in us this morning. Not because we're worthy, not because we somehow elevated ourselves to the place the deserving poor and come forward with empty hands, but because of your great mercy. Father, we are ready now to receive what you have for us. Make us willing and receptive. As our brother, Pastor Steve, comes to proclaim the gospel message to us again, remind us that it's a glorious classroom from which we never graduate, in which we may always learn, and we have a beautiful, dutiful, patient teacher who equips us for every good work. And Father, we are ready to work for you. Do this great thing, God, not because we deserve it, not even because we need it, not only just for our good, but for your glory. So we stand in the name of the one who has saved us, the one who has snatched death from its grasp, the one who is the serpent crusher, the victorious king, the one who is king forevermore. It's in the name of Jesus we ask all these things. Amen.
All right. At this point, we'll dismiss kids for Kids Church, ages 5 up through 5th grade. You guys can head to your classes here now and enjoy those. And while they're going, I invite you to turn to 2 Samuel chapter 23. We're going to be finishing chapter 23 today, and then next week will be chapter 24, and we're finished with 2 Samuel. We started in the beginning of the year, and here we are at the end. And this chapter today, I've been looking forward to preaching it for a while, because it's about David's mighty men. This is a cool chapter. Like, there are some awesome stories in here. And of any day for Pastor James to be away at a retreat and be with the students, I was thinking, man, this could be a perfect appearance of Hans and Franz. You know, when we do that together, we're going to be so huge. We're going to see David's mighty men. They are so puny compared to us. But no, we won't do that today. I just had to throw that in there. This has a collection of stories and a list of people who did things that were amazing, like almost superhuman, that had to be only God helping them to do what they did. So if you have your Bibles there, we're going to start in verse 8 of 2 Samuel 23. These are the names of David's mighty men: Josheb-Bashebeth, a Tachmonite, was chief of the three, and he raised his spear against 800 men whom he killed in one encounter. Wow. 800. Next to him was Eleazar, son of Dodai the Ahoite. There's a couple of Eleazars in our church. That's pretty cool. But I don't think they're the son of Dodai or Dodo, depending on what translation you have. As one of the three mighty men, he was with David when they taunted the Philistines, gathered at Pas Damon for battle. And the men of Israel retreated, but he stood his ground and struck down the Philistines till his hand grew tired and froze to the sword. And the Lord brought about a great victory that day. The troops returned to Eleazar, but only to strip the dead. Next to him was Shema, son of Agi the Hararite. And when the Philistines banded together at a place where there was a field full of lentils, lentils. That's kind of cute, like peas, right? Vegetables. Israel's troops fled from them. But Shammah took his stand in the middle of the field, and he defended it and struck the Philistines down, and the Lord brought about a great victory. During harvest time, three of the 30 chief men came down to David at the cave of Adullam, while a band of Philistines was encamped in the valley of Rephaim. At that time, David was in the stronghold, and the Philistine garrison was at Bethlehem. David longed for water and said, "Oh, that someone would get me a drink of water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem." So the three mighty men broke through the Philistine lines, drew water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem, and carried it back to David. But he refused to drink it. Instead, he poured it out before the Lord. "Far be it from me, O Lord, to do this," he said. "Is not the blood of the men who went at the risk of their lives, or is this not the blood?" And David would not drink it. Such were the exploits of the three mighty men. We're going to pause there for the time being. What we're getting description here is of the three. There's going to be several lists of people as we go on through, but first we're focusing in on the three: Josheb, Beshebeth, Eleazar, and Shammah. All right, they're kind of a mouthful with their names and all the way down through. In fact, you may have had a little bit different translation. I looked between the King James and the NASB and the ESV and the NLT and the NIV, and there's variations in all of them as to how to translate all these things. There's some hard vocabulary words in Hebrew and some complicated names and even some textual variants from the ancient text. They amount to very minor changes in between, but that would account for how yours sounds a little differently, which is fine. But these three would basically be like the Navy SEALs of their day. King David had these elite, physically fit, well-trained, courageous warriors who would be able to do just about any mission that David gave them. They were amazing, and the stories that we read are incredible. So the first guy, Josheb Beshebeth, his feat, it says in here, was that the main thing that he became famous for is that he killed 800 people in one encounter. 800! Like, is that even possible to do that? I mean, it's like something that you would see in a movie, but he did this and became obviously one incredible warrior with David. The next one is Eleazar, son of Dodo. Gotta love his name. Apparently, David and some of the men were taunting the Philistines, like, "Hey, come on over here, see if you can try to beat us." And then the Philistines came, and they came with such force that everyone else retreated, including King David. He was part of that taunting group, and he's gone. And then this guy, Eleazar, said, "Well, I'm not leaving. I'm going to fight these guys." And so he was fighting with his sword, cutting and slashing and whatever you do with a sword. And his hand gets so exhausted, and maybe he was dehydrated too. His arm cramped up, his hand cramped up, and it got stuck on the sword. That's how long he was fighting. And he survived, and everyone else came back to their amazement to just go, "Wow, you killed all these people. Okay, good job, Eleazar." He did an amazing thing that day. Then we get to the next guy, Shammah, in verses 11 and 12. And they were, again, fighting the Philistines, a common enemy throughout David's reign. And he wanted to defend this field of lentils. Maybe he really liked lentils. Or maybe he liked the farmer who owned the lentil field. Or maybe he was just defending his country, which is probably more likely. But here he stands in this field, refused to give up the ground, even when everyone else fled. He did not want Philistines to gain ground. He was fearless. And then there's one more story in this section, verses 13 to 17, when David was hiding in the cave of Adullam. It was kind of a stronghold where he could go to if there was ever a threat. And he had been there during the time when King Saul was always chasing after him for 15 years before he became king. So he knew that place well. Well, the Philistines had invaded so far into Israel, they were now encamped at Bethlehem, which is right by Jerusalem. And David was taking refuge in this cave 12 miles away. And he was exhausted and probably homesick because he grew up where? In Bethlehem. And he thought, man, I would just love a drink of water from the well by the gate of Bethlehem. It would sound so good right now. And three guys overheard it and took it as a challenge. And they went out, made the 12-mile trip, fought their way through the Philistine lines, and got to the well and drew water from it. I don't know how you draw water from a well when you're under attack. Maybe one guy's getting the water, the other two guys are fighting, and then they're carrying a pail of water and still fighting and get their way 12 miles back without being followed and giving away the position where they were all hiding. Like, that's amazing. And David got this water, and even though he wanted it so much, he said, I cannot drink this. It's too precious. It's a treasure. These guys risked their whole lives for this. And he did something that we find pretty strange. He poured it out on the ground. Like, we would think, well, that's kind of a waste. These guys just did all that. At least take a sip. But in the Hebrew culture, there was such thing called a drink offering, where you would worship the Lord by pouring out something precious before him as an offering of worship to him. And so that's what David chose to do. These men were actually honored by that, that David would regard it as such a high treasure that he would do that. Those are some pretty good fighters. Some pretty good warriors. They embodied the best of everything that you would ever ask for from a soldier. Bravery, skill, courage, sacrifice, honor. And they were soldiers of distinction that served with David. Now, I just want to pause right here in our service and acknowledge that we have in this room, I'm sure, some people who have served in our branches of military here in our country with distinction. And so I want to honor anyone who served in any way in your years past. This past Wednesday was Veterans Day, and so it's appropriate to just honor you. Would you stand so that we can thank you for your service? Thank you. Thank you for serving our country. I want to take it one step further, something that I don't think we've ever done before here at this church at least, and that is that if you have family members who are serving or have served, maybe it's a grandparent or a parent, or maybe it's a son or granddaughter or a spouse or a sibling, you are part of the sacrifice in that. Made the ultimate sacrifice and lost a family member, or maybe they just served and they were away in trainings and deployments. Would you stand so we can thank you as well? Yeah, awesome. Thank you. And I think it's very appropriate to honor people who do this for us. There's something about honor that's in this passage that's been preserved for all of these years, almost 3,000 years, where their names are recorded in this book, even some of the things that they did. And as we go down through the rest of the chapter, you're going to see a bunch more names. I think at one level, the scripture here is honoring those who would do that, to lay down their lives to serve other people. And that's very appropriate for us to do. But I want to catch another angle from this passage before we move on. This is from the verses that we just looked at. I think there's something more we need to see from the scripture. And that is that there's a piece to this that these soldiers knew that not only were they serving King David and willing to do that and be part of their nation's, like, the patriotism of it all. They knew that they were serving the anointed King of God, that their nation was the chosen people of God, that God had made promises to them, and they believed in the big cause of advancing the kingdom of God through their nation. They were the light of the world, had been put there, God's chosen people. And they were trusting in the Lord to do these things, so that yes, while they fought and sacrificed and were willing to do what they did, God was also at work. How do we know that? Look at verse 10. It says it specifically as we're looking at Eleazar. It says, but he stood his ground and struck down the Philistines till his hand grew tired and froze to the sword. The Lord brought about a great victory that day. Do you see this other layer here in this passage that God was working through them. Look over at verse 12. It says something similar. But Shammah took his stand in the middle of the field. He defended it and struck the Philistines down, and the Lord brought about a great victory. They understood this tension between it's us, we're serving, we've been trained, we're skilled, we're willing. There's this human element to it all. But God did it. It was Him working through us. We might just be regular people, but we serve an extraordinary God. And we are empowered by Him to do what we've been called to do. Put that thought there in your brain. We're going to get back to that in a minute. But let's pick back up in verse 18 and see a couple more stories. Abishai, the brother of Joab, son of Zeruiah, was chief of the three. And he raised his spear against 300 men whom he killed, and so he became as famous as the three. He got 300. The other guys got more, apparently. And was he not held in greater honor than the three? He became their commander, even though he was not included among them. Next guy, Benaniah, he's my favorite. So Benaniah, son of Jehoiada, was a valiant fighter from Kabzeel. He struck down two of Moab's best men. He also went down into a pit on a snowy day and killed a lion. Wow, okay, we're going to talk about that. And he struck down a huge Egyptian. And although the Egyptian had a spear in his hand, Benaniah went against him with a club. And he snatched the spear from the Egyptian's hand and he killed him with his own spear. Such were the exploits of Benaiah, son of Jehoiada. He too was as famous as the three mighty men. He was held in greater honor than any of the 30, but he was not included among the three. And David put him in charge of his bodyguard. Yeah, rightfully so. All right, we're going to talk about these two guys. So Abishai was put in charge of the three. So he was like the one in charge of the Navy SEALs. Because he was a good fighter. He killed 300 with a spear. But he was the nephew of King David. And his brother Joab was in charge of the whole army. So Abishai was part of this elite family that was overseeing the whole army. And they had a brother, Asahel, as you can read about in the beginning of 2 Samuel. And they were this group that oversaw the military operations for King David. And he's an important character. But I love this character, Benaiah. All right, so here he knew his way around fighting, because there are some amazing stories about him. The first story is that he killed two of Moab's champion fighters. Right? It's one thing to kill one of the champion fighters, it's another thing to kill two. David, remember when he killed Goliath? He was the champion of the Philistines. He was the best one. They'd send their best guy out to fight. And Benaiah did that twice and brought victories to Israel. But then you've got this whole thing about him going into a pit to kill a lion. All right. So a male adult lion can weigh as much as 400 to 500 pounds. Okay? We don't know if it's a male or a female in the story. A female could weigh as much as 200 to 300 pounds, which is still as big as any male that was going to fight, probably bigger. So a lion's roar can be heard from 5 miles away. They have big claws, big teeth. They're made for killing and pouncing on things, right? Benaiah is the kind of guy that heard a roar from whatever distance that he was and had to find out what was going on. I guess like the curiosity got him, and he comes to this pit and looks down and sees a lion, and his first thought is, I'm going to go kill that thing. Now, his dad was from Kabzeel. Did you catch that earlier on in verse 20? Kabzeel, I had to look it up, is this remote place out on in the border of Judea and Edom. It's out in the wilderness in the middle of nowhere. I think Benaiah was a desert redneck. Right? The kind of guy that's just crazy. He grew up just like killing things and hunting and all this kind of stuff. It reminds me of the guys down in Louisiana who go in the bayou and they hunt down alligators. And sometimes they jump out of their boat and wrestle alligators. Like, that's a bayou redneck. I think he was a desert redneck. because he heard a lion's roar and thought, I'm going to go down there and fight that thing. Who does that? And it's one thing to do that when you're going down in a desert area, slip sliding down into the pit, but it was a snowy day. There was snow on the ground, and he went down in there and he fought this lion and didn't have good footing and all this, and he killed the lion. Only one living thing was coming out of that pit that day, and he came out. Interesting. Maybe he wanted the skin. I don't know. What do you do with the lion? But it was good for his resume, because David put him in charge of his bodyguard, and I think David's going, I want that guy to watch my six. Watch my back. And that's what he did. But you know, I was thinking about David. He was kind of a redneck himself. What was his job when he was young? Shepherd, right? Oh, the cute sheep and the shepherd's just nice. No, no, David was pretty fierce. Do you remember what he did? It says what he killed with his bare hands was what? A lion and a bear. And David's like, I like that guy. He killed a lion. You with me. I think that's what happened. And then they get the story about how he killed this huge Egyptian, this giant Egyptian guy. And he had a club, and the Egyptian had a spear. The spear is longer. The spear is more fierce and sharp and pointy. The spear is the superior weapon. But Benaiah snatched the thing out of his hand somehow and killed him with his own spear. Pretty tough dude. As we look at these guys, they are a special breed of fearless, skilled, and courageous warriors. They spent years training, doing all of the exercises with all these weapons, and getting physically fit and practicing fighting and then actually fighting. But they believed in a cause that was bigger than themselves. They believed in the kingdom of God, that was God's people, that he was advancing his kingdom on earth through them. They believed God would come to their aid, and David believed this as well, and there was this culture of, hey, this is God's anointed king, and his purposes are going to be carried out through us. In fact, David would pray about all this. He would ask the Lord, Lord, should we go into this battle? And what would you like us to do? And he trusted that God would guide them and that God would help them to do what they were called to do. As we look back even one chapter past, go ahead and flip back there into 22. We looked at this passage 2 weeks ago, and David said things like in verse 30, with your help I can advance against a troop. And with my God I can scale a wall or leap over a wall. Do you remember that message 2 weeks ago? He literally believed, God's helping me to do this. You go on further down, starting in verse 33. It is God who arms me with strength. He makes my way perfect. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer and enables me to stand on the heights. He trains my hands for battle, and my arms can bend a bow of bronze. He continues on down in the ways that God has helped him and helped him pursue his enemies and defeat them. There was a concrete connection for David. We're God's people. God has made promises to us, and therefore we go where he tells us to go, and we do what he tells us to do, and he's going to give us the victory. There was an incredible amount of faith and courage, starting with the king and then down through his whole military structure, all these people that were with him. David had dudes. I like that thought. I remember just a couple times in my time as a pastor, a ministry leader, just being able to reflect back. I'd love to do this and go, Lord, who are the dudes that you put around that we can work together and who believe and who are courageous, and I don't just mean men and women, who will serve the Lord together, who will just give it our all and trust him for great things. Do you have dudes? Mighty men and women around you that build you up, that have that culture of faith, and we're going to go after what God has told us to do. And nothing's going to hold us back, because right here, right now, this is what God wants. He wants to advance his kingdom on earth through us. Are you willing to sacrifice? Are you willing to go after that? Just think about that a little bit more. We'll get back to that thought in a minute. Let's pick back up in the text, starting in verse 24, because there's a list here to come. It says this: among the 30 were Asahel, the brother of Joab, Elhanan, son of Dodo from Bethlehem, Shema the Herodite, Elikah the Herodite, Helez the Palatite, and I'm not going to even try to read all the rest of these verses, because there's a lot of crazy names in here, and it would take probably all day to get through them. At the bottom it says there were 37 in all. It's kind of counting roughly 30 in this list, plus the two before that, plus the three before that. As I count here, I counted like 29 names, but as I said, the translations are really, really wonky here, so there can be as much as 32 names in this list, depending on what translation you have. But this is the list of the mighty men of David. Do you notice any name in here that sticks out to you? It's unusual. Yeah, I'm hearing it a little bit, rumbling. Verse 39, Uriah the Hittite. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but there's a ton you could unpack from this. Just say a couple of things. This proves that when David took Bathsheba, Uriah's wife, Uriah was no stranger to David. He wasn't just some run-of-the-mill soldier that David had no idea who he was. Uriah was one of the mighty men, which means David had had him into the palace. David had served alongside of him. David knew him well and probably knew Bathsheba as well. It highlights the intentional, almost like stabbing in the back of what David did. It highlights the horrible nature of his sin when he took Bathsheba for himself and then killed Uriah, had him killed in a military operation. That was really awful. But his name's still in this list. Why wouldn't they try to bury this part of history and forget about it? I mean, this is years after Uriah was killed, and they could have chosen other names or just left certain names off. And instead of burying it, God saw fit to have this as a reminder to David of the grace he had shown David. He didn't kill David, didn't even take him out as king. He let David continue on because David had repented of this sin. David had been healed of this in his relationship with the Lord, and it was a public repentance in front of the nation, and they moved on, but it was a reminder of God's grace to David that Uriah's name is here, of how far God had brought him through it all. There's just a lot we could think about in that. But I want to ask a question. That while we have this list of names here, and while we honor these people who did this, it's full of great stories. They risked their lives. They stood their ground in faith. They chased God-sized dreams for his kingdom. It would have been easier to retreat. It would have been safer to retreat, but they went to the risk. They gave it all. Why is this here? Here's my thought. The kingdom of God is still advanced by men and women who are willing to give their lives for the king today. Men and women who have become convinced that they serve a mighty God, and he has mighty purposes, and he has a calling on your life. That as Jesus came to you and brought you to himself as Savior, he's also said to you, now serve me. And here's what I want you to do. He's gifted you by the Holy Spirit with spiritual gifts. And he has a calling upon your life. And so many times we can go, okay, that's not for me. Let other people do that. Or we can say, okay, Lord, I'll serve you, but not like that. I'll only go up to this level, but I won't do that. And these stories challenge us to say, give it all. Sacrifice for the Lord. Believe and trust in bigger things. Have a big God-sized dream that he's giving to you that you'll say, Lord, I'll do that for the rest of my life. I'll do that for you. This call to be men and women who are mighty warriors for God. See, I think of the apostles that Jesus hand-selected. Peter, James, John, all of those. And he said, hey, come follow me. Now, you know that these were just average people, right? Average Joes. Most of them were fishermen. And then there was a few other occupations involved. And Jesus chose them. Said, hey, come follow me. And I'll make you fishers of men. He gave them a God-sized dream right in the moment when he called them to himself. And look what they did. They went out after they had seen all that Christ taught them, after they had seen the crucifixion, Jesus dying for the sin of the world, raising again, the miracle of that, and then ascending into heaven. They had been given a commission, go and share this with the world. And they did. And they turned the world upside down. That was awesome. They were mighty men and women, as there's a whole group of them who God used to change the world. And of course, they were following the king, who was a mighty king, and they believed in his power. But I thought, you know, that's kind of too easy for us to just look at them, because we can go, oh, they walked with Jesus, right? They were the elite that really got to serve Jesus. What about me? I'm just an average Joe. I'm an average Jane. So I was thinking, is there another place in Scripture where it talks about average people commended for their work for the king, for their belief in the king and their service to lay it all down, to sacrifice? And there is such a place. It's in Romans 16. Go ahead and turn there in your Bibles to Romans chapter 16. This is where the Apostle Paul is writing to the church in Rome. He has not yet been there. Someone had gone and brought the gospel to Rome, planted a church there, and you have these believers, and Paul's writing this letter to them with all these greetings of people he wants to recognize for their service in the Lord, people who have actually traveled to Rome that Paul knew. And listen to what he says about them, starting in verse 1. I commend to you our sister Phoebe. Does anyone really know a lot about Phoebe? Probably not. Here's her big mention in Scripture. A servant of the church in Centuria. Anybody know where Centuria is? It's in Greece. It's near Corinth. But you probably never heard of the church. She was heading to Rome. He says, I ask you to receive her in the Lord in a way worthy of the saints, and to give her any help she may need from you, for she has been a great help to many people, including me. Paul had dudes right there. Do you see it? He had people that he worked with, that they served side by side. They were a team in advancing the gospel. Next, he says, greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus. Now, they're a little more famous. They've been mentioned other places in Scripture. They risked their lives for me. Not only I, but all the churches of the Gentiles are grateful to them. Greet also the church that meets at their house. So that's pretty cool. So like the people who are just in their small group, you know, part of their home church, house church. He says, hey, greet them too, because they get to be mentioned now in Scripture for their participation with Priscilla and Aquila. Greet my dear friend Epaphras, who was the first convert to Christ in the province of Asia. Greet my dear friend, greet Mary, who worked very hard for you. Greet Andronicus and Junius, my relatives, who have been in prison with me. They are outstanding among the apostles, and they were in Christ before me. So Paul had relatives who came to Christ before he ever did. Greet Ampliatus, whom I love in the Lord. Greet Urbanus, our fellow worker in Christ, and my dear friend Stechus. Greet Apelles, tested and approved in Christ. Greet those who belong to the household of Aristobulus. Greet Herodian, my relative. Greet those in the household of Narcissus. Oop, that's not a good name. Who are in the Lord. Greet Tryphena and Tryphosa, those women who work hard in the Lord. Greet my dear friend Persis, another woman who has worked very hard in the Lord. Do you hear this theme? Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother, who has been a mother to me too. Greet Asyncritus, there we go, Phlegon and Hermes and Petrobus and Hermas and the brothers with them. greet Philogius and Julia and Nereus and his sister and Olympus and all of the saints with him. And greet one another with a holy kiss, which you can't do during COVID, so don't try it. And all the churches of Christ send their greetings. That's a pretty amazing list of a bunch of obscure people that we know nothing about. But they said yes to following Jesus, and they said yes to serving alongside others to advance the kingdom of God together. Sounds a whole lot like what a church should do. And here's the challenge. We have people in our church assembled here that God has put together at Emmanuel Church. And there's no way I could list all the people who do everything or recognize all the ministries of people who serve. But I just want to connect some dots here today of how important it is that you say yes to serving the Lord in whatever way he has gifted you and called you to do. We have people, this might seem insignificant, but people as a team who will take care of this building and change light bulbs and spread mulch and call a contractor when something needs to be done and oversee all of that. Not because they love a building, although we need to take good care of the building God gave us, but so that this can be a place where people meet Jesus. We have to have a building. We live in Pennsylvania. It's kind of hot and muggy in the summer, but we proved we could meet outside during that. But we cannot probably meet outside in the midst of the cold winter that's to come. We need a building. If you've served on our building and grounds, our trustee team, thank you for what you do so that people can encounter Jesus here. It's important. We have people who take care of the finances every week, who meticulously count the offerings that are given and give the giving credit to who needs to give them and make sure that the bank deposits reconcile with the things that actually came in, what the bank statements are, and then that the spending is tracked and it all meets and balances, and I don't even know how to do all that stuff. But I'm thankful we have people who do. Why? Because they're stewarding the Lord's resources to maximize kingdom impact. Thank you to those of you who work in our financial ministry. We have people right now downstairs who are ministering to children, and they've studied before today. They put time into preparing what they were going to teach to these children, how they were going to present the Bible story in a creative way that the kids are going to understand and be able to apply to their lives. I'm so thankful for people who do that. We have, even on Wednesday nights, an Awana ministry that has had to go to an online virtual version of it, and I see them dressing up in Bible characters so that they can teach on screen with kids on Wednesday nights and still recite the Bible memory verses and everything with the kids. Thank you to all you children's workers who have had to reinvent children's ministry this year. Thank you. We have people who hand out bulletins and open doors and who make this building a safe place to meet, both from threats and also from keeping it clean and sanitized. And thank you for you teams who do that and welcome people well into our church. We have people who came here on Thursday night this past week and practiced the music for 2 hours, who worked through everything meticulously to make sure the notes are right and who work for excellence on that and make sure that the lyrics are right and the screens are working, and then who came at 7:30 this morning while y'all were still sleeping and practiced for another hour so they could do the first service and now have stayed all the way through the second service. Thank you to those of you who do that. It matters so that people can meet Jesus here in this place, and the presence of God can come with no distractions and as best as we can with excellence to worship our Lord together. Thank you to those of you who lead small groups, who welcome people into your home or go into another home but have prepared a Bible discussion, and who care for people, and when the group members are struggling or when they're sick, you follow up with them. And those of you who write encouragement notes to others or call people who might be lonely, or you're caring for the body because it matters. I'm thankful for the fact that there's someone right now in the back booth translating this message into Spanish so that our brothers and sisters in Christ from other languages can be here. Una familia en Cristo. Mis hermanos y hermanas. ¿Eh? Amén, amén. Bienvenidos. I am so thankful that there's a group of people. It's personal to me. I have 4 kids on a youth retreat this weekend. And there's 29 people, including I think 5 or 6 leaders, that gave up their entire weekend to spend with knucklehead teenagers. I have 4 of them, I know that. So that they can worship the Lord together, be called to something deeper in their lives, and a new generation can be raised up to follow Christ. It matters. And we can't make a list of them all, and you're not going to go down in Scripture, but the example is there. God sees it. And today we recognize you. Thank you for serving the Lord. What's your kingdom vision? What's your goal for your life? If it's about pursuing the American dream so that you can earn more money and have a comfortable life and have the home that you always wanted, have a family you always wanted so you can retire comfortably, some of those things are important. But come on, have a bigger vision than that. People need Jesus. And when we get to the end of this world, we step into the threshold of the next world, what will we have to say to our King? What do we live for? Have a God-sized dream, knowing that an amazing and powerful God empowers even people like us who will just say, Lord, I'll serve you. Whatever you want from me. I need you, Lord. So we're going to end this service with a response. I want to call from you a response to say yes to the Lord. It's actually an upbeat song that gets down a little bit. All right? So you're going to have to put your groove on. I'm going to invite the worship team to go ahead and you guys make your way up here. This song is a prayer to invite the King's kingdom on earth, and we say, yes, Lord, I will go. Use me, Lord. And we pray for our earth, that God would do his work in us and through us. So will you stand to your feet and say yes to the Lord and offer yourself to him today? He is the great and mighty King, and we serve him. Go.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Changing.
Jesus, we make that our prayer. Will you build your kingdom and advance your kingdom here in us, in our day, in our place, to the glory of God, that more people may know Jesus and exalt him as Savior, so that the nations might hear and believe and obey, all to the glory of our King, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We bless you and we worship you today. Take us as an offering. Be exalted, O Lord. Amen. Go in peace. Go in God's grace. You're dismissed.
At his voice, trembles at his voice.